Good to see you here tonight. I'm glad that you're with us. I'm just now realizing I forgot to bring my bulletin up with me, but I don't need it. I just want to remind you of some announcements, and one being, it's amazing to think about already, but yeah, Easter is not next Sunday. Easter is two Sundays from today. But if you remember, you know what I like to do, and it's in the bulletin, it's in the looking ahead section of the bulletin. One of the things I like to do leading up to Easter is to prepare our hearts for the celebration of the resurrection in a very unique way. We have kind of a different schedule of midweek services leading up to that. So Wednesday, we'll all, not this Wednesday, but the Wednesday after next, the Wednesday before Easter, we'll all be in here together for a service as we gear our hearts towards the crucifixion, which happened at the end of the week, and then the resurrection on the first day of the week, Sunday. And then on Thursday, we'll have at 7 p.m., we don't normally have a Thursday midweek service, but we will have on Thursday, the Thursday before Easter, 7 p.m., we'll gather in here together, and we'll have specifically a Lord's Supper service. We do that at least twice a year, sometimes more, but I like to do it the Thursday before the resurrection celebration, the Easter resurrection celebration. So every Sunday is a celebration of the resurrection. Amen? Yeah, but it's good for us to celebrate that in a unique way on Easter Sunday. And then Easter Sunday, we'll have, and I've got the time in the bulletin. I don't want to say it and say it wrong, but we'll have an early service, not a sunrise service, because the sun will have been up by the time we come together, but we'll have an early service, and then we'll have a kind of like a continental breakfast, and then Sunday school on Sunday morning, but that will be it for the day. We won't have any other services on Easter Sunday. So all that's coming up. But before that, we're going to have Bibles and Biscuits on Tuesday, men. We're going to have the OCC Diner on Wednesday night, and then we'll have our Easter services. And then April 22nd is the ladies' spring banquet. And there's a sign-up sheet for that, ladies. I encourage you to sign up for that. And also in May, and I'll say this before I mention our prayer requests and we go to the Lord, the Sundays in May will be bookended with special services. So Sunday, which I think is May 1st, the first Sunday in May I think is May 1st, that Sunday evening all the services will be up, the Sunday evening service will be up in the Family Life Center, and the teens will take the leadership. So they'll lead us in singing a couple songs. Jamie is gonna preach, and then we're gonna have a meal together, and we'll pay for the meal. We'll buy our supper up here that the teens will have prepared, and all the proceeds from that are gonna go help towards the teen camp. You know, camps are very expensive weeks of ministry, very worthwhile, but very expensive weeks of ministry, and so we want to all the proceeds from that supper that night are gonna go to our teens going to camp. And until we can get that van, you know, until China starts shipping chips, we're down when it comes to transportation. So we have an added expense both for the juniors and the seniors and getting them to camp, because we're going to have to rent vehicles to get them back and forth. So that's May 1st. And then the last Sunday in May, the Sunday of the Memorial Day holiday, we will have our morning schedule, like typical. Well, we did this last year, if you remember. We will have Sunday school, and I'll preach the morning service, and then we'll just matriculate up the hill under the shelter and stuff, and we'll have hamburgers and hot dogs and chicken breasts like we did last year. Brother Charles is in charge of the grill, and then we'll eat, and we'll have just a real brief devotion out there, you know, in front of our food, and that will be the day. That will be the day on this. I don't know what the date is, but it's the Sunday of Memorial Day holiday. So just want to make you aware of that right now. Keep Brother Sam in your prayers. He went into surgery about an hour, 2 hours ago. He went into surgery. I was talking to Brother Danny, and it is surgery to repair that new hip, part of that new hip that got injured in his fall, but also the break. He broke his femur on that same side. So I want to keep him in our prayers. And Miss Connie was telling me that her 92-year-old uncle, Tom Mangus, fell and had a hairline fracture in his hip. There's been a lot of falling going on. Brother Bill Fain fell, and we want to keep him in our prayers as he's recovering from that. So just keep these prayer requests before the Lord. And pray for little Cannon Williams as well, as he's having these issues with these febrile seizures, and they've seen a specialist up in Cincinnati Children's. So you just keep them in your prayers as they seek to find out what's going on there and how to treat that situation. So let's go ahead and have a word of prayer together. I'm going to ask James if he would to lead some prayer. Good news about James. We thought he'd broken his arm, but it's not a break. It's a severe sprain, right? And so we praise God for that, and he's got to take care of it, but we're happy that it's not a break, but just a sprain. So James, why don't you take us to the throne, brother?
Thank you.
Sit down. Father in heaven, we thank you for the truth of always being able to go to and call upon you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And when we call on Jesus, all things are possible. And we praise you for that marvelous truth. And that's because, Father, you are the rock of ages. And you are the sure and firm foundation for our feet at all times. And may we recognize that marvelous truth and live accordingly. And there are times we are shaken to the very core of our being because of what we experience or what we've done, things that come into our life of no fault of our own, and things that we endure because of our sin. But Father, we thank you that you are our rock, and you are the one with whom all things are possible, and through Christ, through Christ alone, we have access to you. And that is a glorious thing. And Father, may we avail ourselves of our Lord and Savior at all times and in all situations. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You can find in your Bibles Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. So I'm going to read here at the start. I forgot to mention, shame on me, because I should have said this already, but we had a work day yesterday, And I really appreciate Miss Debbie. She always organizes that and does such a good job of that. And I appreciate all the hands that came out to get the work done. And we got a lot of things accomplished and things. It's good for us that there's repairs that were made and improvements that were made and things that were cleaned up. And we're still working towards that. We want to take care of the property, the facility that we have, because this is a tool. Amen? This is a tool to be used for the ministry of the Lord and for the glory of His name. And we want to make sure that we take advantage of all that. And so I appreciate everybody who was here and a part of what we did yesterday. It was a great blessing. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. Did you know that Jesus spoke about money more than any other topic? We've been discussing on Sunday nights. I've been going through a series, This Changes Everything, talking about how the gospel impacts every aspect of our lives. The genesis of this of this series of lessons and the outline that I'm following is from Jason Allen's book, Being a Christian. And we recognize that if the gospel changes everything, it's also going to have an impact on how we spend our money. And that's also reflected in the fact that Jesus, as I just said, spoke more about money than any other topic. 16 of Christ's 38 parables reference the handling of our earthly treasure. And in the Gospels, if you look through that, one out of every 10 verses when Jesus is speaking addresses money. He spoke more about money than he did about heaven and hell. And that lets us know that money is a big issue, right? Just by the fact of how often Christ spoke about it. Now, I know in my own life that what Jesus has said and what's recorded in God's Word about Jesus' words needs to be important in my life and important to how I lead myself and lead my family. And what Jesus has communicated to us through His Word is that which should direct our paths. And since that principle is true, we need to think intentionally, not accidentally, not incidentally, but intentionally about money, just as Jesus spoke intentionally about money. He died to redeem every aspect of our lives. That's what this whole series is about, how the gospel changes everything. And so the gospel, if it changes everything, the gospel is going to affect our bank accounts and our spending habits. It transforms all of our lives. It transforms the way we view and use our money. And I think one of the reasons why Jesus focused on money so much is because money is a barometer. It is an indicator that reveals a whole host of data points about our heart, what we find important and where our focus is. Our view of money uncovers our motives, our ambitions, our insecurities, our greed, our internal value system. Few things reveal our heart like money does in the way we spend it. And so the love of money is always corrosive. There is nothing positive about the love of money. It is corrosive. The love of money will decay your heart. It will pollute your ambitions. It will stain your Christian life. And yet, just like I talked about this building and these facilities and these 7 acres or whatever it is exactly that we own up on this hill, this building here and the Family Life Center and the shelter and the garage, just as those buildings are tools, money is a tool that, when rightly utilized, can bring about much good for the cause of the kingdom. Amen? Money, rightly stewarded, provides for our families, supports our churches, helps our missionary endeavors, cares for the needy, generates a host of other biblical and practical goods. And so we have to consider this rightly. And so Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. I've said this before, both from the pulpit and in counseling sessions and whatever else. I like to mark up my Bible, and in the book of Proverbs especially, you probably can't see it, but I use different color ink. I think that's important, and it has a it has a place. The different colors I use, is it has a place. But in the book of Proverbs especially, wherever there's a proverb about money, you'll find in my Bible a little green dollar sign. And it just helps me recognize right away as I look at it that this is sections of the book of wisdom that has to do with money in specific. And verses 9 and 10 of Proverbs 3 are a couple of those verses. Honor the Lord with your substance and with the, what's that next word, church? The first fruits of all your increase. So shall your barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. And so, as we consider this passage and other key passages of Scripture, as I said, Christ focused on earthly treasures and godly stewardship, and other biblical authors did as well, like the Solomon here in the Proverbs. And what I want us to do is reflect on a couple of the major passages that speak about money. And you can follow along these places if you want, holding your place there in Proverbs chapter 3, but we're gonna look at, I'm going to read about four passages from the New Testament. The first one is Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 20. Here's what we read from God's Word. Let me get over there. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 20. Jesus is speaking on the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust do corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your," what? "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Can I say just on the way, Sir Brother Thomas would call on the way preaching, that doesn't mean that if you're poor, you're more righteous than people who are not poor. Amen? The level of your bank account is not equal to your level of righteousness, because you can be poor and be just as greedy and just as envious and just as whatever else when it comes to money as somebody who has more money than sense and doesn't know how to use it. Does that make sense? How much money you have has nothing to do with how righteous or unrighteous you are. It's the love of money, not the possession of money, that is corrosive. And Jesus is not saying here that if you're poor, specifically if you're poor because you won't work, then you're somehow more righteous than other people. He is saying that we need to lay up treasures in glory and not lay up treasures in earth, because the treasures on this earth are all going to perish, but that which is laid up in glory will not. And then look forward to Luke chapter 16, verses 13 through 15. And here again, we will read what God's Word has to say concerning this topic. Luke 16, verses 13 through 15. "No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other." Now, this is true no matter what we're talking about, but God, Jesus, and the flesh specifically connects it to money. You cannot serve God and mammon. And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, and that's one of the reasons why he's talking about this. This is one of the reasons why he brings up money in specific, because he knows their hearts and he knows they're covetous. And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things and they derided him. Because here's what often happens when you hear truth that you don't like. Instead, you will either submit to it, you either humble yourself and submit to it, or you will start to rip on the person who's proclaimed the truth. In verse 15, "And he said unto them," Jesus said unto them, "Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God." Now let's look to the epistles, and specifically in 1 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6. Verses 17 through 19. Now we're going from the words of Jesus to the inspired pen of Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, no less authoritative than what Jesus has spoken, but coming from the inspiration, the inspired pen of Paul the Apostle. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. "Charge them that are rich Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. They that do good, they that be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on it in eternal life. And then finally, Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews, chapter 13 and verse 5. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5. And you're just going to read one verse here. Let your conversation, and that's King James English for conduct. Let your conduct be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And again, the problem of covetousness and the problem of contentment, you know, we all like the stories of the Rockefellers and others who never seem to be content, or that's the way you hear it preached sometimes, or that's the way you hear it rehearsed sometimes, not just from a preacher, but from some cultural commentators that always had more and were never, it was never enough, and always desired more and schemed and dreamed and even did dirty deals to get more and more and more, as if people who had very little to nothing, as if they're immune from that. Being covetous and being discontent has nothing to do with the level of your income and everything to do with the condition of your heart. And so we need to recognize that, and we need to fight against that. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I do want to say this. If you can't make it, if you can't live without, if you make $10 an hour and you're constantly saying, if I could just make more money, I would be able to give, I would be able to do this, I would be able to do that, I'd be so much better off. If that's your mindset, then you don't understand that if you made $30 an hour, you'd be saying the same thing. It's just you'd be making $20 more an hour, as if just having more money is going to fix the problems. The problem isn't, now look, Travis, you can have this job that pays $30 an hour, or you can have this job that pays $10 an hour. Most likely, I'm going to take the former. You understand? But if you're looking at your problems financially and otherwise based on how much you make an hour, you're looking at it wrong. Because the problem is the way you're spending what you have, how you look at what you have, and not what you have and how you're using it. So these passages, Proverbs chapter 3, and these passages that I've read here just recently, they're going to help us evaluate our earthly wealth. They're going to help us understand what it means to redeem our wallets and honor our Lord with our earthly resources. Billy Graham said this, and I really appreciate it. He said, if a person gets his attitude toward money straight, it will help straighten out almost every other area in his life. That's pretty interesting for one of the premier evangelists of the 20th century, if not the premier evangelist of the 20th century, to say. That if a person gets his attitude towards money straight, it will help straighten out almost every other area in his life. And so let's look at some principles that help us approach money from a redeemed perspective. And the first thing is this: love the provider, not the provision. Love the provider, not the provision. If you read with me Proverbs chapter 3, and you read that we should honor the Lord with our substance and with the first fruits of all our increase, and then verse 10 says, so shall your barns be filled with plenty, and your presses shall burst out with new wine. If you read that and you think to yourself, okay, well, this is an investment plan. I'll give a tithe to the church, and as long as I don't miss my tithe, then God's going to make sure that I have that I get top wages and good rates on this and that and the other thing. If you look at Proverbs 3, 9, and 10 as just a quid pro quo, I throw in the till and he'll make things pleasant for me financially all the time, then you're misunderstanding what God's Word has to say here. The point is that we are to honor God with the first fruits of all of our substance, whether it's a little substance or not. And God will bless that. And oftentimes that blessing is going to be realized financially, but maybe not all of the time. But He will meet our, as we are taught to pray, He will meet day by day our daily needs. Amen? And what we need to love is we need to love the provider and not His provision. Look with me in Matthew 6, again, a section on the Sermon on the Mount. And one of the reassuring realities of the Christian life is God's scrupulous care and His lavish generosity on His children. Not only is He able to care for us, but He's committed to caring for us. Not only does He bless us, but God delights in blessing us. And so in Matthew chapter 6, verses 26 through 33, the problem is we always have an idea of what that of how those blessings should look. And when our view of God's blessings don't match the reality of His blessings, that's when we get all out of sorts. And we need to have a right view of what it means to be blessed by God. So Matthew chapter 6, verse 26, "Behold, the fowls of the air, the birds of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take you thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast in the oven, shall He not much more clothe you? O ye of little faith. Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things." Y'all read this next verse with me. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And again, if you have followed along with me, you say, man, I've heard that before. And if you're thinking that this somehow means that we don't work, that we just kind of sit around and quote-unquote pursue spiritual things, and God will put food on the table, and God will put clothes on our back, and God will put a roof over our head. If you're thinking that Matthew 6, 26 through 33 is somehow teaching indolence and laziness, then you then you're coming at the Scripture with a skewed perspective instead of with an open mind to hear what the Spirit is saying. Because He's not promoting indolence. He's not promoting laziness. He's not promoting anything like that. He's not saying that we don't work. He's not saying that we don't sacrifice in all kind of areas. What He is making known is that God delights in and will meet our needs. And that we are to seek His righteousness first. Not so that means that everything about our life is to be spent in serving Him and not in serving achievement or dollar signs or any kind of other pursuit. The reality of the Christian life is that God meets our needs and often far surpasses our needs. And as He provides, we must worship the provider. And as He gives, we should certainly enjoy His gifts. But we must delight in the giver most of all. And so that's a good question to ask yourself. What do you like? What do you enjoy more? Do you enjoy the provision more, or do you enjoy the provider? And it needs to be the provider. And many times, it's been the case for us as American Christians, that provision is pressed down, overflowing, and running over. But if you associate joy in Christianity and the goodness of God only with a certain level of blessing, then you're going to be disappointed. The blessing, the love is for the provider, not the provision. Number two, so that's the first one. Here's number two. Pursue contentment more than prosperity. This is key. As the Apostle Paul teaches us, and we read this in 1 Timothy 6, godliness with contentment is great gain. The reality is, discontentment is like a leaking bucket that never can be filled, no matter how much you pour into it. So think about discontentment like that. You got a hole in your bucket, and no matter how much God pours in, there's an amount that's constantly leaking out, and you're always discontent because you got a hole in your bucket. But if you look at contentment like an artesian well, it will never run dry, regardless of how much you take out. It will spring up and overflow. Paul David Tripp, in his book on the Christian life, talks about the love of money is really about contentment. Love of money is about humility. Love of money is about identity. Love of money is about worship that really roots at deep issues. Maybe the most subtle of all the indications of love of money is an ongoing, chronic discontentment in me that no matter what I have, I am still not content. And if you think you're going to find happiness with a new vehicle or a new address or a new dress or a new bow or a new whatever, if you think that is going to be the key to contentment, well, then you'll be happy. You'll be content for a week or two or till the shine rubs off. But then what? You know, I love these commercials. I love the Christmas new car commercials. Not because I think they're heartwarming. They're not. Not because I think that they're teaching something positive, because they're certainly not. But these Christmas new car commercials teach, from a negative perspective, this very thing that we're talking about tonight. Specifically, that we're to pursue contentment rather than prosperity. I can't remember the exact model of car, but it's a hilarious commercial because you so many of these commercials, you know, that they walk out there and there's a new car. Never happened to me, you know, on Christmas, and I don't expect it ever to happen to me. But they walk out there, and there's a bow on this new truck or this new SUV or this new car. And the one that's my favorite is the lady goes out there. Husband's bought her a new car. She goes out to the parking lot or the driveway, and oh, she's excited for the new car. And then she sees another new car driving down the neighborhood street. And that's the car she really wanted. That's the car that really hits all the bells. And she just is looking at that new car. Her new car is right in front of her with the big red bow on it, and husband smiling and the kids clapping, and she's got only eyes for the one that's driving down the street because that's the one she really wanted. And some automobile company thought this would be a great way to promote the fact that you want our car, not somebody else's car, and maybe it is, but nothing represents American consumerism better than that commercial. Here, I've got a brand new car, but I'd really rather have that when it's driving down the road. I could go on with those commercials forever, but one example would be enough. What we need to do is pursue contentment, not pursue prosperity. We need to realize that in Christ, here's the key, beloved, in Christ, you have all that you need. Every spiritual resource, and he will meet every physical need. So be content in him. Here's number three, recognize your stewardship. What I'm talking about here is you need to view all that you have through the lens of stewardship. One of the things I love about the Lord of the Rings books, and the movies are okay, but one of the things I love about the Lord of the Rings books is the whole idea of the return of the king, but you got this guy who's the steward of the kingdom of Gondor, and he's been a steward. This line of stewards has gone on forever, so there's been this unbroken line of from father to son of people who have stewarded the rule of the kingdom of Gondor because the king has been absent. But here's what can happen. Especially, it doesn't have to take a long period of time, but here's what can happen over a long period of time. You begin to think that instead of the steward, you are the rightful heir and owner of all that you have. Are you following me? And it's one of the greatest lines in that third installment of the Lord of the Rings book, The Return of the King, is the steward, Denethor, says about the king, who is the rightful heir to the throne, he says, the rule of Gondor is mine and no other. And that's how we often think about our bank accounts. And not just our bank accounts, but our bodies. You know, you don't have to be a health nut. You don't have to be a fanatic when it comes to physical fitness. But you do know you've only got one body to serve the Lord with. And just like this building is a tool and that building is a tool, and just like our vans are tools for the ministry, this body that you have is a tool to be used for the glory of God. And it's not used, you go flexing and whatever else, saying, look how glorious I am, and doesn't that make you want to glorify God? Absolutely not. But it's what you use to tell other people about Christ, to serve other people in whatever capacity you have. And so we need to take care of this tool, right? One day God is going to resurrect it, and he's going to glorify it. And so we need to recognize our stewardship. To be a steward is to recognize that you are not the owners of your possessions. You're just the temporary overseers. And you need to take advantage of it as if it was your own. You need to protect it and invest it be wise with it as if it was your own. But you need to recognize that you're just rightly stewarding these material blessings, storing up for yourselves in the process treasures in heaven. A fellow named Ray Ortland has written the following. He says, we are accustomed to the biblical message that we should trust God, but here's another smaller and subordinate but still important category, that God would trust us. If we are not faithful with money, which is unrighteous and not worthy of much, who will entrust to us the true riches of spiritual wealth and power? In other words, if we can't handle cheap things wisely, why would God put far more precious things into our hands? Does that make sense? Pastor Jerry Locke put it this way, and you all, he's preached here since I've been here, and I think he's probably preached here before that. Yeah, but he's told me, and I may get this wrong, somebody will watch this and maybe give him a hard time, but I'm pretty sure he's the one who told me this, that when it came to the use of a church van, church is giving him, just having a hard time about using the church van for this thing or that other thing. And he said, hey, look, if you can't trust me with the keys of the church van, don't trust me with the souls of your children. Amen? I mean, if you can't think that I'm accountable to drive the church van here or this for that other thing, then you're going to let me stand up and open the Word of God? And I know we can take some illustrations like that too far, but we need to recognize that we're stewards, and we need to recognize that if we can't handle cheap things wisely, then why would God put far more precious things into our hands? So, are you being a faithful steward? Are you being a faithful steward over what God has entrusted to you? Here's number four. Prioritize giving to God. I've heard people say that they will give to God when they can afford it. This is especially true in the $10 an hour category, you know. That's usually where that comes up. So somebody says to me, hey, Gilbert, if I made $30 an hour, I'd be able to give to the ministry of the church. But, you know, I only make $10 an hour. And so, you know, why don't you go over and talk to them? Why don't you go over and talk to them, you know, and whatever else? Not that I've, you know, ever singled somebody out as if I even know what people give, but these things come up in conversation. These things come up in stewardship. These things come up in counseling. And so the thinking is that if I just made more, if I just earned more, then I'd be able to give. Well, that is unbiblical and foolish thinking. If it's like a young married couple saying, we'll have a baby once we can afford it. When can you ever afford one, right? And now I know we can be unwise about those things, but, you know, kids are expensive, and they never stop getting and being expensive. They never do. That type of thinking will leave you without children if you think you can only have children when you can, quote-unquote, afford children. And the same thing is true when it comes to giving. Delayed obedience is always disobedience, including with our money. And so we need to recognize that we are to give God, as we read, our first fruits. And many of us fall into this pit of thinking that that you, either we can't give, or we can't afford to give, or other people need to give. And what we need to recognize, and I think we live under the new covenant. I think a 10% tithe, and that's what tithe means. Tithe means 10%, and you can look up places like Malachi 3, verses 7 through 10, and specifically, and it's very explicit about that, where the people of Israel were commanded to give a tithe. But that wasn't all they were there. They were also commanded to give other financial contributions towards the temple and towards the priests as well. But under the new covenant, when you look in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and 2 Corinthians chapter 9, which teach us in very explicit terms on the nature of giving, I'm not going to stand up and say that 10% is commanded for people to give under the new covenant. I do think there are times when people who are struggling financially, maybe even that amount would be too hard for them to give, at least for a period of time. I think 10% is a good place to start, and we should give a tithe and an offering. The reason I don't like to draw a hard and fast percentage is because there are some people, and I think very few, especially in our culture, there are very few who would just be ground under because, especially during this time in their life, they just can't reach that 10%. That's a very few number of people. But the far greater number of people only give 10% when really they ought to be giving more to the work of the Lord. You hear that, Bob? It's totally quiet in here. I mean, not everybody. I lost them all on that one. Yeah, there are seasons in our life, and there are times when if we're given 10%, and that's where we cap it, you know, we're not giving generously or cheerfully. Now that's between you and the Lord, and between you and nobody else. But I want you to think about that. I want you to pay attention to that when we talk about prioritizing giving to God. When we look to the New Testament, especially the Apostle Paul's teaching, we find an emphasis on grace giving. And that should frame our thinking, not just viewing a 10% ceiling, but really, I guess you could say, a 10% floor for most of the time and for most people. We need to seek His will as strategic, cheerful, consistent givers. Prioritize giving to God. And that's why we need to be good stewards, as especially church leaders, because people are giving of their hard-earned income for the work of the ministry, and we need to make sure that we're stewarding that to the best of our ability and for the glory of the ministry of the gospel. Amen? And not take that for granted, and not squander it. Number five, don't forget God's provision. In the Old Testament, God's people were commanded to not forget His provision, and when they did, it always came with very negative consequences. They often build monuments. I love the book of Joshua, as the people, and that's a book that so many people can claim is a bloody genocidal book. And obviously, we don't fight our battles for the Lord in the same way. For the main difference being that our enemies are not flesh and blood, but spiritual wickedness in high places, powers and principalities of the air. But that was not the case in the economy of the Old Testament. And so these battles played out differently there. And just as we are to be radical in putting away sin in our life, when it came to life in the Old Testament, especially as they took over the Promised Land, that took on a whole different perspective. Don't judge God. Don't stand in the place of God, stand in God's place and judge Him and say He's cruel and genocidal. Every one of those Canaanite people could have turned and trusted Christ like Rahab did. Amen? That pagan prostitute, she knew very little of God. Here's what she knew of God. that the God of these Hebrews who are coming up out of Egypt, he is stronger than every other god. He's stronger than the 10 gods of Egypt that were defeated with the plagues, and he's stronger than Og and Sihon's gods, and he's bringing those people into our land, and I need to put my faith and trust not in myself and not in my gods, but I need to put my faith and trust in this Hebrew God. And that's exactly what she did. And that's exactly what everybody who went into her house did. And they were saved, and so would have everyone else if they would have turned in faith to the God of Israel. Amen? But they didn't. And the fact of the matter is, everyone will be judged, whether it's no matter how that's played out, and you will be judged, and you will stand before the righteous one. And the only hope that you have is if you've put your faith in him, or if you haven't, if you put your faith in someone else or yourself, then that won't do. And there will be death. And there will be death. And in Joshua, at every turn, when they crossed the Jordan River and God stood up the waters like he did at the Red Sea, and at other events, they would gather up these heap of stones, and it'd usually be one stone per tribe, and they'd heap these stones up, and it wasn't an idol, and it wasn't an altar, but it was a memorial. And the whole point was so that future generations could say, hey, Dad, hey, Papa, what's the point of that pile of stones? And they, you'd say, let me tell you, son, here's what that's about. Here's where God won this victory. Here's where God did this. And what I'm getting at here is that we need to do that as well. God's word reminds his people of the danger of forgetting God's provision. And so you need to build a memorial in your heart and in your family of God's provision. Don't forget his provision. Number six, and we're just about to the finish line. Let's value working and saving and investing. Don't value get-rich-quick schemes. Don't value being lazy. Don't buy into the idea that you need to spend, baby spend, to help the American economy. No, value working, value saving, and value investing. One of the things I hate so much about the way our nation, I don't care which side of the aisle you're on, but so many, especially of liberals, but even of so-called conservatives, want to look at spending as what's necessary to fix a bad economic situation, when really what needs to happen is working, saving, and investing. And sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is also the most practical. We're called to be people of faith, but that doesn't mean we're not diligent. That doesn't mean that we don't work hard. That doesn't mean that we're prudent. If you think faithfulness is a lack of prudence, if you think faithfulness equals laziness, then again, you're looking at it all wrong, and you need to reorient yourself. Paul exhorted Christians that if they did not work, they should not eat. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. I should have had that on the screen, but let me read it real quick. And it's just right in the middle of his commands about other things. But he says in 2 Thessalonians 3:10, for even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat. And to Timothy, he said, especially when it's talking about taking care of one's family, 1 Timothy 5:8, he says, if any provide not for his own, especially for those of his own house, he has denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. That's King James English for an unbeliever. That's what an infidel is. An infidel is an unbeliever. And so Proverbs also commends us both to save and to invest. And if you look at Proverbs 21:5 and Proverbs 13:11, wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathers by labor shall increase. Those are passages in my Bible that have a green dollar sign next to them. We need to value working, saving, and investing. And again, you can take this to, if you value working, saving, investing, that doesn't mean that you value it to the point that you're not at church, that you're not serving the Lord, that you just are trying to, you're not seeing your job as a means to communicate the gospel, but just as an opportunity to gain wealth. That's not what I'm encouraging at all. But I am encouraging us to value work, saving, and investing. We are to be wise financial stewards, not people who are looking for a get-rich-quick scheme. I say this every time I do premarital counseling with a couple and we talk about money, but I can remember so well right around the time that cell phones were beginning, they were on the scene, but not everybody had one like we do today. And everybody, it's not just a cell phone anymore, it's a smartphone everybody has. But this was right around the time when cell phones were starting to become kind of normal, but not so normal that everybody had one. Diane and I didn't have one yet. But we had some friends who were, they didn't want to call it a get-rich-quick scheme, but they were selling, but it was still a pyramid, right? So you have somebody, I'll sell Travis and I'll sell Bobby phone cards. That's what these were. And then Travis, you know, he'll get Jim and Jill, and Bobby will get Tommy and Danny. And then number one's making money, and two and three are making money. And you see how that works? And they'd say, Travis, it's not a pyramid, but it sure did seem like one to me. And the funny thing is it's phone cards. Who uses a phone card now? You know, my kids don't even know what a phone card is. My kids don't even remember a phone being in the house. You know, a phone that's actually got a cord that goes into the wall, you know, and you buttons on it, and before that, the dot. They don't have any memory of that. I don't have it on me, but all they have memory of is a cell phone. You know, we didn't invest in the phone cards, and it's so hilarious to me because the only people who get money, and people get money out of that, but the only people who get the money are the people who get in at the top, and then everybody else is just helping make them money. Let me land a plane, because some of you probably sold those phone cards, and you're going to get mad at me when we get all finished here. Number seven, cultivate the heart of a cheerful giver. There is a remarkable breed of believers who have found the joy of giving. You know, I have found out that the people who have the best attitude when it comes about money are people who cheerfully and joyfully give. You know that? And a lot of times, it's been my experience, those are the people who are the most well off. They love to give. They relish in the ability to bless God's causes and God's people and their community. And I have to say, as I land the plane tonight, that one of the things that I love so much about this church, and it has nothing to do with my pastorate, it's been a part of this church for decades, and speaks well of you and speaks well of Brother Staten's leadership. But this is one of the most generous churches that I've not just been a part of, but been aware of. With the way that we seek to meet needs in the community, as well as people, you know, missionaries and others, and it is a great blessing. Amen. We have been blessed much, to bless much, and as every man according as he purposes in heart, so let him give, not grudgingly, not of necessity, because God loves a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says. And we need to cultivate the heart of a cheerful giver, not cultivate the heart of always expecting somebody to give to me. That's the heart that's being cultivated in our country right now. The heart that says, "Well, there are some people who think that just showing up to the job means that they earned a paycheck, right? And they can be like this most of the night, but doggone it, they're there. I mean, they." You know, and they don't have the understanding that we are to work, not just have a job, but to work at the job. You know, some people are content just to apply for a job, because then they can apply for a job and they can show the government office that they've at least applied for this job or that job, but they didn't get the job. They didn't get the job because they didn't even interview for the job. They applied for the job. They can show that they applied for the job, and they can get that government money, that good government money. That's the problem, church. in our culture. And we as God's people have to live in such a way as we cultivate the heart of a cheerful giver, because we value working and saving and investing. And we need to fight against this idea that people who value working, saving, and investing are somehow misers that hold on to the dollar bill with a death grip, and they don't want anybody to have anything else. Because that's not a biblical viewpoint. There might be people who are like that, but that's not how God's people are to be. And so these are seven biblical principles that will help us to redeem the money that we have, no matter how much money that we have. We live in a fabulously wealthy nation. And I think that there's always going to be temptations when it comes to the money and how we spend it. But we should not negotiate away our spiritual inheritance. We should not compromise our Christian convictions when it comes to the testimony of the gospel. We need to view money as God views it, as a redeemed asset, and purpose to steward it accordingly. And as we do so, our money will be a vehicle for God's glory in our lives. So let's go ahead and bow for a word of prayer. I'm going to ask the musicians to come. We're just going to sing a song to close out our service. We're going to have a word of prayer together. Remember these prayer requests that we mentioned. Remember what we've heard from God's Word both this morning and this evening. Keep Brother Sam in your prayers. Keep Brother Bill Fain and Miss Connie's Uncle Tom Mangus in your prayers. Aletha's having surgery on Tuesday. Keep her in your prayers. She won't be with us on Wednesday night when we gather. And pray that we would be people who want to use our resources, especially our financial resources, as we talk tonight, for the glory of the kingdom. So, Father in heaven, may we do so. And I thank you for a church that does. I don't necessarily think this is something that, on a whole, we as a church don't understand and don't do. But it's good to be reminded of what we already know and commit ourselves and recommit ourselves to doing what we should and what we have been. I thank you for a generous church. Father, I know from being a part of Rogers that so many missionaries, when they travel through this part of the world, feel like they're really living on faith, because love offerings can be so little and hard to get from place to place. But this church has been such a blessing. It's been such an oasis for people. And that's all for your glory and for the cause of the gospel. And Father, may we continue to be a blessing to those who are missionaries, be a blessing to those in our church who are hurting, be a blessing to those in our community who have no connection to our church except for friendship with church members, but who we're able to help. Father, I thank you for that. May we continue to be a blessing, and through that, glorify your name and have an opportunity with the gospel. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Let's sing through this a couple times, Ethan, and we'll sing two verses, and then we'll be dismissed.